Hi, this is Tom, Junkie XL. Welcome to Studio Time with Junkie XL. And today we're going to be talking about how I write for strings. There's going to be two movies about that, and this is part one. And in this particular video, I want to focus on a theme that I wrote for a character called Liz from the movie Brimstone, directed by Martin Kolhoven. This is an alternative European movie with American stars like Guy Pearce and Dakota Fanning. It's a wonderful movie that takes place roughly 200 years ago when the first European settlers arrived in America. So the story takes place in a very small congregation, very religious, and we see in this movie how rough life was back then for women. But this character, Dakota Fanning, her name is Liz in the film, is this really strong woman, a heroine actually throughout the whole film, and she's been followed by this reverend that's played by Guy Pearce, this really fierce reverend. And it's a very terrible movie in the sense that you really see how women were being treated back in the day. But to a certain extent, we might wonder if we look what's going on in the world right now, if it has changed all that much in certain parts of the world. But I don't want to give away too much of the story because it would be a spoiler. You have to see this film. It's really good. But the music for this film is it's very emotional. It's very heavy. And Martin, the director, and I both have a really strong feeling with classic Hollywood approach to film scoring from the 50s and the 60s. Great examples, Bernard Herrmann, Goldsmith, but also Italian composers like Ennio Morricone. And I want to take you through step by step how I got to the theme for her and how I wrote the strings for it. And the theme, as we're going to hear it right now, not only was written as an original suite, but actually appears in the movie exactly how we're going to play it right now. And I'm going to play you first. I'm going to take you through the melody first, then how I do it for strings. We talk about harmony a little bit. And then finally, we play the final result with the live strings that were recorded. But I'm going to mention a little bit more about that later on in the video. Okay, so let's go to the computer. Let's go to a piano sound. I'm using ivory for this, a really nice warm sounding piano. And let me just play very simple what the melody is. I wanted to be, it needed to be sad, but it also needed to be a little bit of hope. It's like, can we go somewhere else than just the sadness? And you will see that after I play the melody, and I will explain it a little more. So this is what the melody became. And there I made a mistake. It doesn't matter because I wanted to quit anyway. So there we transpose to D minor. I'll talk about that more later. So let's go back to the melody. So the melody first seems to resolve, and then when the melody comes again, it ends with a question. So when the melody ends at first, it ends. So that feels resolved. But then when the second time the melody plays, it goes. And that's the question. And then it resolves and it goes to... Anyway, I made a mistake again. Doesn't matter. We'll see in a minute what it actually became. The other thing that I talked about is that leap is, you know, that thing of hope. So it starts really sad. So in that jump up, it feels very hopeful for a second, and then slightly it starts to fall apart again. So let's now go, for instance, to a cello, because every time when I figure out a melody, I usually do it on a piano, very bare bone like this, and I sit for days and days just to figure out how I want to do it. And now when you play it, it seems so simple. And you're wondering, why did it take me days to come up with this? But I don't know, that's, I guess, what the process is. So let's now go to a cello, and then I'm going to check if the melody actually works on a cello. So let's just see. In this case, I'm using cinematic strings, which is one of my favorite string libraries. And this is actually the old cinematic strings library, so not the update. I really like the old one. And I just open up my notepad here, and then you can see here my key switches that are pre-programmed here in a notepad. So it's not by clicking on them, they will actually immediately activate the switch. It's just a reminder, it's like, okay, these are the articulations that I have. So we're gonna select a legato patch, so it's monophonic, and that's, I have to press the E and the B flat, and that will give me the... the monophonic cello. Okay, so let's now see if our melody still holds up if I play it on a cello. I really like that. So, and then I knew, okay, so when the melody comes back and it ends on that question, I want to play that on the violin. So let's now go to our violins, see if the patch is right. And if it's not, we press E and B flat, which are the key switches that I need to press to get a monophonic legato violin. Let's see if it works. And it works. Okay. So let's set our levels right, and let's just see if I play this melody an octave higher, how that would sound. And this is the second half of that melody. Actually, I'm gonna play it again because I forgot to play the variation on the top end. Mistakes are made easily. I wrote the music for this film actually a year ago, so my brain cells are slowly trying to get together how I figured this out. But let me play it another time so there's no mistake. Good. So I actually really like that. So let's now go to our MIDI part, the first MIDI part of the cello. And you can see I recorded this in here. This is actually from the original moment when I wrote it, but I just wanted to play you live what that cello line actually looked like. So let's just check one more time. This is okay. We're now looking at the key edit screen in Cubase, and we see the velocities here, and the velocities have a little bit of impact on how the strings work. So if the velocity is very quiet, then the note starts like really slow, and if it's a higher velocity, it bends together quickly with the other notes. Then we see here a lane with expression data. Expression in this sense for the cinematic strings is, it's basically just an extra volume, because I have volume here and there. So usually what I do, as you can see here, is I set my volume at one point, and then with expression I'm going to help the performance of the string line if the modulation alone is not enough. So modulation gets me usually pretty far, but sometimes I want to be even more quieter, and you see with my expression lane here that I'm actually doing that while the volume stays the same. At the end of the line, you see that expression goes almost to zero, but I felt it needed more help coming down, and there you see that the volume is coming back a little bit. And then exactly on the next note, volume is back again on the same note, and then we see mod wheel doing the information and expression helping with the volume on that end. So let's just play this section until the reiteration of the melody. And a nice and a quiet out. So that's the opening of the melody statement. So let's now go to the first violin, where we just decided to play the second half of the melody right there. So we see something similar here. We see that the first note is very quiet in velocity, which means that it has a really nice swell going into it. And for the other notes, they're all connected somewhat the same way. And the same for this F here, right there. It also slow velocity, so it's a low velocity, so it slowly comes in. Also here we see that my volume is at one level, and again on the B3 there, it needs a little extra help fading out, and then we're back to the normal level. So in this case, I'm going to continue playing after the second reiteration of the melody, and then you see how I finish the melody right there, transposing to D minor, and then we're coming back. Also here you see the mod wheel information that basically mimics the way that players play. The more mod wheel, the more louder the string player plays in a natural version. And if I feel it needs a little extra help, you see the expression data is somewhat following what the mod wheel information is doing. So I'm going to play the second reiteration of the melody that ends with the question, and then we transpose to D, and then you hear how the melody ends this piece of music. So that's our question, and we transpose to F. Thank you. and then it ends. So while we have now played the whole melody, we do sometimes feel what the harmony potentially could be, and sometimes we don't, because you need a second note and a third note to really define what the harmony is going to be. So what I would like to do right now is open up the cello again, but now I'm going to open up two cellos, and now we see the top melody line here as we just played it. And the other thing that we see is now the lighter color underneath are the root notes played by another cello section. So for this recording, I had the cello is a very important part of the of the score. So I think we had 12 or 14 cellos, and the bottom cellos, I think about 4 or 6, would play along with the basses, always the same note, an octave apart, and then the top cello line would always be the other players, like 6 or 8 of them. And sometimes during the recording, we would say less cellos to the bottom, more cellos to the top, or vice versa. You always have that freedom to do that during a recording to bring out the melody better if that's required. So let's now go back to this. Let's play just these two parts together. And now we're getting a way stronger sense of what the, bless you, we're getting a way stronger sense of what the harmony is going to be with this melody. But we're not 100% sure in an analytical sense, because you need a third voice to really define it. But it gives a really good sense where it's going. So let's play till here. So now we have a way stronger sense of what this harmony is. And we see, you know, some one sexy note here, the G sharp, towards the E to get back to A minor. Now I want to go to the second section where the violin is taking the lead in the melody. And again, I'm going to open that up with the bottom cello line to see what the harmony is doing there. So for some sections in this section, we're now pretty sure what the harmony is going to be, even though we're just playing two notes. So in the opening here, that's pretty much A minor. Is that going to be G major, or is that going to be E minor? It's already hinting at it, because the melody is staying there on the E while it's dropping to the G in the root. So maybe it's E minor, maybe it's G major. Let's just see. And then the melody continues. We're hearing an A and an F there playing against each other. that could maybe be F major, but it could potentially also be D minor in the first inversion. So we can't say for sure yet because we're just listening to two notes. Same happens here on this note that sounds like this little section here. So the melody does E, F, D, while the root note is a G sharp. So at first it could mean, maybe is it E major in its first inversion, but then when it goes to the F, it turns very slightly into a diminished chord, and then it goes to the D, and then it turns into a dominant chord. So we don't know for sure with just two lines, so I just wanted to point that out. But what I've learned over the years and studying books is that what I've picked up is that once you have a melody, you should be aware of what the harmonic consequences are of that melody. But then at the same time, you should start with a melody and then start playing the root. And that those are the most important ones. And then you start working on other melody lines in the middle. And what you do have to remember, though, when you write for strings, you should write melody lines. Don't write chord patches, because string players don't feel inspired to play anything like that. Sometimes you have to, because you need to have some sort of a droney environment, but string players are melody players. So you need to have melodies for the bass, for the cellos, for the violas, for the second violins and the first violins. And then when all these melodies play together, a harmony will come alive, and the main melody and the counterlines that go with it. So that's an important thing for strings in general. So now, let's bring in I'm going to leave the second violins and the violas out of it for now. Let's just open up just the celli, the basses, and the violins. And there's one harmony on the violins happening. So you now see it's progressing now a little bit. So what is confusing maybe to see here is that the bass is an octave higher than the cello here. That's not because the bass is playing an octave higher, but cinematic strings, the way that it's laid out, is that the low C of the bass, which is C0, is right here on C1 on the keyboard. That's exactly also where the low note of the cello is. And that's basically comes from the classic theory that a bass is always written an octave higher than it's actually being played, because otherwise the notes would be so incredibly low on the music paper that it wouldn't make any sense. So that's why that is. So when you see a bass here playing an A2, it sounds like an A1 because he will play it an octave lower. So it's a little cumbersome, but that is how this library works. So don't let that confuse you. Let's play this. So let's stop right here. So now we have a way better clue of what certain harmonies actually are. So I just want to focus on this section here. So this E of the cello is continuing playing while the G is the root. And now we're seeing an E and a B here on top. So now we know for sure that this chord was actually an E minor in an inversion. So now we're starting to see a little bit more what the harmony is. And also here, when it goes to this section, the F section, we see a D in the root, an A and an F on top in the melody. So now we know for sure, okay, that is a clear D minor. So now I want to bring in the second violins and listen to those. And you see now the arrangements gets like quite a little bit fuller. And you will see that I'm trying to echo the main melody. Let's see if we have this string thing. So the movement that's in the melody. For instance, or. I'm talking about not only the notes, but also the movement of the notes. And I'm trying throughout the arrangement to see if there are moments where the melody is not playing, the main melody, if I can counter that with some of these movements in some of the other voices. So let's go back to the beginning and let's now play it with the second violins added to the celli, the basses, and the violins. So the violas are still not part of this. We're going to add them after this. So now we see way more harmony presented, and now on a lot of occasions we really know now what the harmony is. There's just one or two spots where it's maybe is still like a little question. So let's now look at what this second violin is doing. So here, let me put this on. When it starts playing this section here, that is actually almost an echo from the second part of the melody when it does the variation. And it basically gets introduced right when the first melody is playing his jump up. So there are a couple of things like that where we see that coming back, and that makes it nice and coherent. And I like that, usually how that sounds with strings. And let's now see when we bring back the we haven't even looked at them, the violas. The violas always add an incredible color in the mid-range to a string arrangement, and it's my favorite instrument to write counterlines with, together with the cellos. They have such a nice frequency range together, whereas the violins play the melody in a higher register. So let's now see what I came up with the inner voices. Thank you. So now you could see how, you know, how really nice the violas are actually filling up that whole space between the violins and the cello, and it almost sounds like choirs sometimes. So that's how nice it feels. Also here, I'm just gonna accent this section right here. You see how the viola is echoing the violin line there. Little things that I like that, you know, that come back. So that's pretty much what my string arrangement is. It's actually very simple. And now that I'm going back to my main screen, I mean, this is my whole session. It's 2, 4, 6, 8, 9 programmed strings. And what I actually now want to do is bring in the recording right here. And in this, I want to talk to you a little bit about. Let's see if this is all working. Yes. So I want to show the strings in a bit when I play back the final result. We recorded this score in Belgium. And we went to the Galaxy Studio, which is an absolutely wonderful studio. Wonderful players from the Brussels Philharmonic, primarily a few players from the Netherlands. And but we recorded there on Saturday and Sunday, the day before the terrorist attack on the airport. And the attack happened while we were already just back in LA, and it was really weird. So it was now listening back to this score, which is already very sad and very melancholic, and then knowing that that happened in Belgium, it just gave like a really unexpected dimension to the music, so to speak. Anyway, now I'm just gonna shut up talking, and I'm gonna play this whole thing now lively recorded in Belgium. But we're still gonna look at the notes. I'm just gonna zoom in a little bit, and I will scroll with you through the piece so you can still look at the notes. I might even zoom out a little bit like that. I just don't wanna lose the high notes, but here we go. And that was that. I hope this was a little helpful to show you how I like to program strings and write strings, and how I work with the melody and with the harmony. And this is the end of Writing for Strings 1, and there will be another episode, Studio Time with Junkie XL, which also focuses on strings, more on what you can do with harmony. Thank you for watching. See you the next time. Bye.